Grandma used to pray out loud by your bed every night. To me it sounded like mumbling, like she was out of her mind. She said, boy, this kind of praying, it's what saved my life. You ought to try it sometime. And now I know she was right. She was talking to Jesus. She was talking to Jesus. And she'd been talking to Jesus for all of her life. Mama used to drag me to church Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. Khaki pants and a polo shirt. Boy, I put up a fight. She said, son, one day you'll thank me for having God in your life. And yeah, I know she was right. Yeah, my mama was right. Cause now I'm talking to Jesus. She got me talking to Jesus. She got me talking to Jesus. Yeah, my mama was right. Cause now I'm talking to Jesus. Yeah, I love talking to Jesus. And I'll be talking to Jesus for the rest of my life. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Don't you know? What a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, what a friend we have. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Whoa. I've got three of my own now, trying to raise them upright. My oldest is 15. I remember what that was like. Trying to deal with the drama, trying to figure out the questions in life. And I've been looking for a way to show him how to make it all right. Then he walks in my room while I was saying my prayers the other night. He said, I'll come back later. I can tell you got a lot on your mind. I said, it's not an interruption. You couldn't have picked a better time. Cause I was just talking to Jesus. Come over and give it a try. We started talking to Jesus. Bad time to start. It don't have to sound pretty. Just tell them what's on your heart. Cause it's not a religion. Cause it's more like a friendship.
Just talk to your father like you are his kid. Just start talking to Jesus. Just start talking to Jesus. You can talk to Jesus, oh, whenever you like. Just start talking to Jesus. Just start talking to Jesus. Just keep talking to Jesus the rest of your life.
Happy Earth Day Sunday and fourth Sunday after Easter. We thank you for joining us at Faith United Methodist Church for worship, as we have 8:30 and 10:30 a.m. services, as well as having a 9 a.m. Nichigo service. Our 10:30 a.m. service, you can find us on Zoom as well if you want to participate live with us. Things will be changing in the near future as we continue to find ways to reopen our church, and we will continue to update you on those changes. But for now, we want to welcome you as you relax in your own homes, but making that a sacred space as we come to worship God. And as we do so, whether it's on YouTube or Facebook, as you share the worship services with your friends and family, we ask you to come in with a time of peace on your hearts. We recognize as this is a time where we are celebrating the earth and God's creation, we also know that our world is a place that is not always calm and peaceful. So let this be a time and a moment for you to connect with God again. Let us hear these centering words to do so as we prepare our hearts for worship. When we love with our lives, we become reflections of God for all to see. You're welcome to join us in our opening hymn today.
Burden, I will carry you. I will carry you, my child, lay down your burden. I will carry you, I will carry you, my child, I'll carry you, my child, I'll carry you.
Love one another, even when love involves risk.
We love as God loves us.
Love and care for others, even when caring is hard.
We love and care as God loves and cares for us.
Love in truth and action.
By this, we are known as children of God.
Let us bow our heads. Shepherd of love, guide our thoughts and our actions, that we too might become shepherds of love. Speak to our hearts as we listen this day, that our hearts may expand and embrace all of your sheep. Love us fully, that we might love all of the flocks of your world as fully as we are loved by you. In your shepherding love we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone. It is children's time. So I would like to ask all the children and all the children in us to gather around for this time. This past Thursday on April 22nd of 2021 was Earth Day. So today we're going to talk about Earth. And to everyone that's joining us, happy Earth Day. And thanks be to God for this opportunity to praise God for the goodness of the creation. What should we be thankful for? For so many things, right? It's hard to focus on just a few. We should be thankful for the forest. We should be thankful for the clear water that flows from the mountains. Or how about we're thankful for the bald eagles? How about we're so thankful for killer whales? How many killer whales do you see in this picture? How about being thankful for the flowering shrubs that give beauty to our neighborhoods with flashes of pink and yellow flowers? How about being thankful for the flowering shrubs that give beauty to our neighborhoods with flashes of pink and yellow flowers? How about giving thanks for the variety of human life? And yes, how about even giving thanks for rain? For all that we have and all that we are, we owe thanks to God. God created heaven and earth and said it was good. And although we believe man is special in God's world, we are merely a part of the creation placed here by God. Creation belongs to God. The land, the water, yes, the animals, the air, all are God's. Have you ever just taken time to look at a rainbow when it's just rained? They're absolutely and truly marvelous, right? No one who has seen them can possibly doubt God's love for us. How are we supposed to take care of the earth? Well, that's a good question. But the great thing is, the Bible provides help. In the beginning of the Bible, when God placed the man in the garden and states, "Till it and keep it." This means we have the right to till the earth in order to make it fruitful. But does this mean we are to till all of it? No. We also have the duty to keep it, which means to protect it, to keep the earth by conserving it. Till it, yes, but know when to stop. God speaks to me through the mountains. Always has. Perhaps for you, you feel closest to God at the beach. Or maybe the lake. Well, for me, and perhaps for you, nature is the most real sign of God's presence. Our spiritual journey is still more mystery to me than understanding. But day by day, one step at a time, with God's help, the understanding grows. If we will take the time to listen for His guidance and read His holy word. So let's take this time to pray. So join me. I want you to close your eyes and join me in this prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this occasion to think about your creation and our duty to be good stewards of these gifts. Help us to know that each of us has a key job in caring for the earth by the choices we make and by the actions we take. Give us good judgment to choose thoughtfully and to act with care, to show our love for you and your love of this good earth, our home. Have a happy Earth Day. Amen. And now the choir will sing, "You Are Here," and dedicate this song to the memory of Marcus Grimes, who passed away this week.
Good morning. This morning's scripture lesson comes from the book of Psalms. It's the 23rd Psalm, and it's very familiar to all of you. And it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long." The word of God for all people. Thanks be to God.
Oh, good morning. Well, welcome to, again, just being together. Thank you, Minister Eric, for reading Psalm 23 to us. And when we read that, we know how important it is to each and every one of us who've really heard those words in sometimes the most important moments in our lives. Last Sunday, for those of you who'd viewed in and checked in with us, you have all heard the announcement that starting July 1st, I will be appointed to my new charge in downtown LA, Centenary United Methodist Church. And yes, as I've been feeling this whole week, it's been very bittersweet. And I mentioned that last week when we talked about it from a prayer perspective as well. But as we move forward, the one thing that's going to remain constant in all of our changes is the Good Shepherd. Amen. And as I think about that, I just want to go ahead and just start this morning with prayer. So let us pray. Dear God, as we come together this morning, I just pray the words from my mouth and the meditations of all of our collected hearts will be one that is honoring and pleasing to you, O Lord. Amen. Well, Psalm 23, what more can I say? You know, we've been preaching out of the lectionary schedule for the last 4.5 years, and today falls on Psalm 23. And in some ways I go, is that appropriate or is that just challenging? Because Psalm 23 means so much to us in so many different ways, and it means a lot to me as well. And I didn't realize how much it meant to me until I went through that time with my mom back in September 2020, and how much I needed the Good Shepherd, and how much in many ways you all out there and the pastoral staff have been a good shepherd to me in my time of need. And there have been times where we've been able to shepherd all of you in your time of need. And it's so wonderful to have a community recognizing that we are all extensions of our Good Shepherd in heaven. But today, as I talk about the Good Shepherd, as I share about Psalm 23, I didn't want to talk about it from the perspective of just a funeral, because it seemed like that's when we hear it most. But when I think about Psalm 23, I go, well, what does it mean to be a shepherd? What does it mean to learn about sheep? And there is a lot to learn about sheep, because you hear Jesus talking about sheep a lot, especially in the New Testament, even though Psalm 23 is right in the middle of the Old Testament. But as I think about this and I read about this, I remember the time when a few of us were heading to Mammoth to go for a little fishing trip. And on the way there, and we've been to Mammoth many, many, many times, but this one particular drive up north, we were sitting, and all of us were sitting in traffic. And thankfully, our car was like the second car. And so we were like, what are we waiting for? Why is this car stopped? And all of a sudden we realized, what is going on? And you see just this huge flock of sheep that's being guided across the road there. And I go, oh, I don't think I've ever seen that. You know, to see sheep in this desert, it just seems all odd. But then I guess when you read the scriptures, it's kind of all, you know, it's kind of throughout scriptures. So it's really interesting to see how without that shepherd, I tell you, the sheep would be in big trouble. That flock would be in definitely big trouble. But thank God for the Good Shepherd. And I tell you, there's times in our lives when we truly need the Good Shepherd. Amen? When I think about the Good Shepherd, there's four things that I think about. The Good Shepherd as our provider. The Good Shepherd as our protector. The Good Shepherd as our healer. The Good Shepherd, ultimately, as our host as well. When I think about the Good Shepherd, yes, I think about sheep, of course. But when I think about sheep, I think about our children in so many ways. I think about day camp. Every year since I've been here, especially the first year, I remember experiencing day camp and I go, wow, this day camp is awesome. Whatever you have all done throughout your time as North Gardena and Faith United Methodist Church and as Gardena First, really coming together to prepare and organize day camp, man, it's an awesome experience. And every year, it would culminate, except for the last few years, but every year, it would culminate on Friday, and on Friday used to be beach day. Oh, and I was like, what is beach day? So the older kids would end up going to the beach, while a lot of the counselors, not most of them, would go to the beach as well. And I tell you, when you're part of day camp and you enlist as volunteers, you get to experience so much joys. But the beach thing is like, that's the cream of the crop when it comes to day camp. All of our children, all those fourth and fifth graders, we round them up, get them on the bus, and we go to the beach. And I can only imagine what God has to do with us, you know, constantly providing for us, constantly protecting us, constantly trying to provide healing for us, and constantly hosting us in many ways. But when I think of God and providing for us, and I think about day camp, how many times did we think about going to day camp and going to the beach and all the different ways in which we needed to make sure that our kids were safe? The way God provides for us is amazing. And here it says in Psalm 23:1, the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. Now, I don't know how many of us can actually say I lack nothing, but I think in this terms it means just that God continues to provide for us whenever we need. And a lot of times, that doesn't mean just food, it doesn't mean just physical sustenance, but that God provides for us with his presence. When we go to day camp and we go to beach day, thank you for all those who volunteered over all these years, especially those who go ahead of us in our field trips, and you would go there, and when we get to the beach, we know where our spot is. You know, we get off the bus, and we have all these kids jumping off the bus and going, where do we go, where do we go? And like, just follow the canopy. And at the canopy, we have a bunch of wonderful volunteers who provide shade for us. They put up the canopy, they put down the tarp, they have all of our lunches in boxes, and the kids are hungry, they're now getting ready for the beach. But before they have, we have to calm them down, we have to corral them, make sure that we count each and every one of them to make sure that they made it to the beach with us, that they got off the bus. And I tell you, when you're on the bus, I mean, it's like probably a flock of sheep. You know, some are sleeping, some are excited, some are a little too loud than others, but it gets a little bit wild even on the bus. And when we get off, just to see the canopy and to see all of our volunteers, to wave us and say, we're over here, and we gather. And then from there, I say, the way they provide for us with food, with shelter, with covering, so that we can put on our sunblock and get ready to go down to the beach and have a lot of fun. And God continues to provide for you and me, right? God is our protector. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And I think about those words and I go, well, what do we need protection from, right? Why do we need God to be our protector? And I think about it, when we're sick, you know, in the hospital, we ask for protection. Sometimes I believe that when we're sick, it's times when we probably feel like sometimes we're at a point in our faith journey where we feel like we find the most doubt. And I think sometimes we just need to be protected from doubt, because there's nothing in some ways more important than having faith in our good shepherd. When we're sometimes sick, or when we're angry, or when we're upset with somebody, I tell you, doubt or just frustration, things that cloud our judgments, they come and sometimes have a prominent voice in our hearts, and we need protection from that. God wants us to think straight. God wants us to think faithfully. God wants us to make sure that no matter what, his spirit is there to protect us from any doubts, from any, you know, even bad teaching, false teaching, as you all know, you know, during our pandemic, during all the racism that we've been experiencing, now all the anti-Asian hate, and sometimes it's so easy to go ahead and put up arms and be ready to fight back in that way. But you know, Jesus never did that. And so I go, well, if Jesus is nonviolent, sometimes when we say protect, we think about physical protection. But in many ways, I think God is calling us to take a moment and breathe and just pray and not react, but to respond. And sometimes that response has to be stern, but not necessarily violent, not necessarily physical, but definitely spiritual, definitely relational, and definitely done with a lot of wisdom. You know, when we're out there, I tell you, when you're out there with day camp on a beach day, we have all the kids, and before they get out there, we get all of our high school kids who volunteered to be shepherds at the beach. They go out there and they build this wall right in the water, and they have their back turned to the ocean. And so that way they build this sort of protective wall around our children, and then they hold hands to make sure that none of our children can go out into the ocean. And they don't go that far anyways, but when you're the counselor holding that, and especially if you're the shorter ones, oh, water's coming over, and you can kind of see all of our counselors, they take such a beating from that water. Sometimes they don't have to look back to see if there's a big wave or not. And then those of us adults who are on the sand, we're saying, here comes a big one, watch out for that one, watch out for the kids. And then if some kids want to wander off, then we have to bring them back together, simply because we want to make sure that they're in an environment where they're safe. And I can't wait for all of the young ones to experience this one day. If we continue beach day on top of that, because I know even the beach regulations have changed, but I still remember just how much our counselors have given themselves in that water and get just beat down by this ocean water just so that our kids can have a great time. Because when they see their counselors, I tell you, you can see that in their eyes. They feel so protected. Counselors, high school counselors, if you've been a day camp counselor, thank you. Because all of the parents who've raised kids in this setting, when they go to the beach, I tell you, in this first grade, second grade, third grade, they're like, I can't wait to be a fourth grader. I remember when Eli and Jew said, I can't wait to be a fourth grader in day camp because we get to go to the beach. And they get to experience feeling that protection from their high school counselors. I tell you, you're going to have to just see it one day. You're going to have to see it one day. But it's a wonderful and awesome sight. And I can see how God continues to do that with us as well. Whenever we need God's protection, He surrounds us with these arms of loved people. And thank you. Thank you if you've been a protector of somebody else when they didn't have a voice and you were their voice. When they didn't have strength, you were their strength. Thank you, because God continues to call us to protect one another, especially in times of doubt. And then you think about the Good Shepherd as our healer. Psalm 23, verse 3 and 4 says, the Lord restores my soul, and you anoint my head with oil. You know, when we think about oil, especially anointing with oil, a lot of times in scriptures, it's written in a way where when oil is brought, it's healing oil. It's embalmed with healing powers. And when there's prayer, and then there's folks surrounding you with love, there are times when we've been hurt. There are times when someone has hurt us with vicious words. These days, there's times when someone has hurt us with physical violence. I get that. But in many ways, I feel like the healing isn't just about healing from those pains, but also healing is part of forgiveness. Healing is being able to move forward and saying yes to God, even amidst times of troubles and tribulations. When I hear the word, the Lord restores my soul, we need it. When so many of us have gone through this pandemic, and through that, so many of us have lost loved ones, sometimes we just need the Holy Spirit to come and restore our souls. We need time to be restored in our times of grieving, and so many of us will be grieving. And in some strange ways, there'll be people who'll be grieving coming out of the pandemic, because in some strange ways, all of us who've been so busy running around with our kids from one activity to the next, the pandemic was terrible. But in some ways, even in times of terrible, God continues to bring good things. And in that time of pandemic, some of you might agree with me, we were able to spend way more time as a family than we've ever in our time as parents. And so once the pandemic gets lifted, I have a feeling we're going to probably go right back to our hectic schedules. But I do hope that as parents, we do learn. I do hope that as families, we do learn. I do hope that as a church, we do learn that the healing process is sometimes when you heal, you get even stronger, right? When people who have broken bones and my kids are always breaking bones, and Caroline, I go, I don't know who they come from, because we've never had broken bones in our lives. But our kids continue to have broken bones for whatever reason. But I realize when they heal, they come back stronger, really. They come back stronger. So I do pray that even though in some ways we might have been broken down by this pandemic, and of course, I feel really bad for those who we lost, who weren't able to come back in person with us, but we know now that they're stronger with the Lord, and we all need healing, and we need to help heal each other in these times, and I just pray that we would come back stronger in the process of healing. Thank you, Lord Jesus, really, for being our healer, and I ask that we would just be healing sources for one another. And above all, the last part of this Psalm 23 for me is that the Good Shepherd as our host, it says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And actually, before I go on to this, as far as the healing and connected to day camp, I just want to say thank you to all of our day camp nurses. All of you who participate as a nurse, whenever any of our kids were sick with a headache or feeling just nauseous or just even a simple cut because they just got out of hand or whatever, you know, anytime they came to one of our nurses, they knew that nothing can go wrong from there. They knew that our nurses were always going to be there to help them heal. And that's such a wonderful quality. But now as we think about providing and protecting and healing, thank you, God, for being our host. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The Lord is our ultimate host. And for those of us who are a part and members of Faith United Methodist Church, may you continue to host anyone who's looking for a home here. And I know when we hear these words, a lot of times it's a reminder of the grace God gives each and every one of us, that when it's all said and done, God is welcoming us back into his arms, into the arms of the kingdom of God, into the arms of heaven. And we always tell each other, remind each other, you know, we rest from our labors so that the Lord can continue to embrace us and renew us even in the next life. We may be absent from the body here, but we'll always be present with the Lord. And I think about that as a day camp, you know, director and pastor. You know, my main goal when we go to the beach day as a host, my main goal is to make sure that each and every one of them get back home here to Faith UMC safely. When they get off that bus, I want to be able to count every single name that went there with us, and I hope that they would come back. You know, and so far, knock on wood, we haven't lost a kid yet, and we don't plan to. But I think that's how God looks at us as well, that when it's all said and done, the Lord wants to be able to count each and every one of us to make sure that we all made it home as well. Folks, I recognize that, you know, as July 1st rolls around, and it is an elephant in the room, and I don't want to go ahead and dismiss a very, you know, obvious topic, but when I think about it, the bus to the beach, you know, it was in many ways, you know, I would always go to the beach because they needed my presence there. And I remember one year we were going to the beach and the driver took us in the wrong route. And even though she had a GPS, I had to tell her, you're going to have to make a U-turn because the beach is over there. And as pastors, we're always driving the bus. You know, Reverend Allison's driving the bus, and she has helpers driving the bus with her. I was a helper. Minister Eric was a helper. Pastor Becky was a helper. And we had all these helpers. And I still remember my first year when I came, you know, Reverend Derek was driving the bus, and Reverend Ken was a helper, and I was helping. And then when Reverend Derek was appointed to Pacific Northwest, Reverend Ken then became the new driver of the bus. And after Reverend Ken, it was Pastor Kathy. And after Pastor Kathy, now it's Reverend Allison. And they're continuing to drive the bus with as much faith as possible. And I recognize now that I've been called to drive a different bus. And I know it sounds strange that I'm even speaking of it this way, but it's true. We're all going to be called to drive our buses, maybe not as pastors, but maybe as parents, maybe as those who lead a group, or maybe as just those who are mentors to your children, your grandchildren, your uncles, you know, your nieces and nephews, your friends. But in reality, I look back now and I realize how much you've all been my good shepherds. I know I've been asked to help you in your time of need, but I tell you, you've been there in my time of need. We've all taken a portion of how God has led each and every one of us to help one another. We've provided for each other. We've protected each other. We've healed each other. We've been a host to one another. And now you have you've had a driver for the last 2.5 years, Reverend Allison, and she's going to continue now to join you and continue to lead you and continue to serve you, continue to provide and protect and heal, and then also be the ultimate host here at Faith United Methodist Church. I know that first year especially is going to be tough because we all know when I go on to Centenary, you're going to have to give me my space so that I can be present and be a bus driver and a good shepherd over at Centenary while Reverend Allison continues to be that good shepherd here. And so it's not going to be easy. I get it. But this is something that we're all called to do. And so may you continue to serve and to offer your time here at Faith United Methodist Church. And all that I've learned from all of you, I will take, obviously, to Centenary. All the stories and all the narratives that and all the lessons that I've learned here, I will take to Centenary and do my best to be present there. So as I share this, it's just a reminder of what you already know about Psalm 23. It's just a reminder of what you already know about our ultimate Good Shepherd. He calls on every one of us to provide for each other, for our neighborhood, to protect each other, especially our images, especially our hearts, to really protect our hearts and our faith, to heal one another in times when we mean to forgive and confess even, and then also to host one another every chance we get. And of course, hosting also means invitation. And really, as a host, I pray that this is one of these churches that it's a beacon in this area, in the South Bay community. And I pray that this place will be a place where you can host all those who are looking for a unique faith experience. And Faith United Methodist Church, there's no place like Faith UMC, especially here in the South Bay. So I pray that you continue to hear God's voice and to be guided by our Good Shepherd as we move forward. Amen. Let us be reminded that we continue to belong, ultimately all of us, to God, to Jesus, and as the Holy Spirit continues to guide us. Grace and peace, folks. We'll talk together again soon. Amen. Well, now as we enter this time of pastoral prayer, I'd like to lift up, for those of you who have not heard, want to lift up the family of Marcus Grimes, who passed away this week of complications. For those who recognize Marcus' situation, we lift up Stephen as well, who even though took on Marcus as a client, really was more his guardian and his big brother and his mentor, who helped Marcus introduce Marcus to our faith community, and our faith family loved on Marcus, and it's been such a blow. And so we lift up Marcus Grimes' family and Stephen Ballard, who's cared for him all these years. God, I can't even imagine what they're going through. At this time, for those who would like to go ahead and offer your support, or even monetary support for the situation that they're in right now, yes, we would invite you to offer your support and make your support, if you're going to write a check, to Faith United Methodist Church, and we'll gather all those for you and offer it to the family as they prepare for Marcus's celebration of life and support and help they may need as well. So we'll just go ahead and name that as it is. We also like to lift up the situation that we're continuing to be in with all of the violence and hate and racism that surrounds our nation, and specifically, especially after the deliberation of the decisions made around Derek Chauvin's case. We just pray for all parties who are involved in that, anyone who's been hurt because of that very situation, and of course with all the different hate crimes that are happening just in our nation alone, we ask for God's presence in all of that. And with all that said, you know, we continue to move through changes and know that we're going to remain faithful to God, who continues to be our constant good in all of these difficult changes that happen around us. So let us go together in prayer. And after I do lift up our prayer, I'm going to invite Mina Katayama to lead us in our Lord's Prayer. So please join me now as we pray. Let us pray. Dear Lord, as we come together, recognizing you as our good shepherd, and we need a good shepherd to be present amidst us. As we think about our loved ones, like Marcus, and we know, Lord, now that he is absent from the body, but now is truly present with you, thank you for introducing him into our lives. Thank you for introducing him to Stephen's life. And thank you, Lord Jesus, that we got to experience this tender and calm and innocent soul that really made an impact in our faith community. And Lord Jesus, we know that now we all have faith that he is in good hands. But for those of us who've been left behind to mourn and grieve, Lord Jesus, I do pray for the family of Marcus Grimes specifically. His mother and siblings, Lord Jesus, may they find comfort and hope in these times of just challenges and difficulties. We lift up Stephen to you as well, Lord, our fearless and faithful choir conductor and director, who more than just leading us in our choir and singing and music ministries, Lord Jesus, is even a better human being in that way, just always having that compassion for those who really need his presence and love. Thank you for instilling in him that the seed of grace and love that really no one else has like Stephen Ballard. So thank you for his kindness and just how you have just blessed him and others through Stephen, Lord Jesus. And also, Lord, for those of us who are dealing with all of the different kinds of racism and all the different kinds of just separation because of hate and violence and just because of wicked and evilness, that evil that continues to exist around us, Lord, I pray your goodness will be even bigger. We pray that your grace will even be bigger. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that as you touch every single one of us, remind us of the goodness by which we've been created in, Lord, I pray that we would offer one another sound advice and wisdom and just spending time of prayer in moments of discernment that we need so that we don't react, but truly respond with your sense of presence of love and grace. Lord Jesus, we know that we need you, and we know things are changing and continue to change, and changes can be good and are good, but in those changes, it's not always easy. So we pray, Lord Jesus, for your guidance and your presence in our lives. Bless us all. Bless us all so that we may continue to live according to your will, according to your guidance. And I pray, Lord, that your word and your guidance is the lamp by which we follow our lives. Lord Jesus, thank you for being our good shepherd. Thank you for being the one who continues to provide all our needs. Thank you for being the one that continues to remind us, as you protect us, you guide us to protect one another. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for bringing us spiritual and relational healing by which we always need, and even physical healing sometimes. And Lord Jesus, we just also thank you for always being the ultimate host, inviting us to participate and to partake in your wonderful communion and baptism, above all, Lord, in just offering us your grace and your home and your relationship. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And at this time, as we continue to move forward with gratitude, I'd like to go ahead and invite our lovely and young Mina Katayama as she leads us, all of us, Lord Jesus, in the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Well, thank you, Pastor Key, for that great message. At this time of offering, we want to thank you to all those that have continued to give to the ministries here at Faith. But if you're looking to give to the ministries here at Faith, there are a number of ways that you're able to. One is you're able to continue to mail in checks or drop it off in our church mailbox. That's an option. You're also able to give online through our website at faithsouthbay.org. You could also give through Venmo, which is a phone app, and we're also on Venmo as well. But at this time, as we say a blessing over the offerings that have been given, we just continue to thank you and to continue to are just so grateful for everything that you guys have all been doing those offerings. Shepherd of love, bless these gifts with the power and presence of your love. May your love bring healing to a world in need of your touch. May your grace bring hope to a world in need of your promise. And may our love be a sign for all to see that you, who are love, are present in the world today. Amen.
Thank you, Minister Eric, and thank you, Pastor Key, for your word today. And we also want to thank our worship team for putting together our worship services every week, especially during these pandemic times. We're very grateful for all of you. And today, we had the Katayama ladies sharing in our worship today. As we go into a time of going forth in God's holy name, before we have Pastor Key give you the commissioning and benediction, we want to share with you our faith in action, some of our ministries of Faith UMC, and the opportunities that you can participate in, even though we are still not yet coming back in person, but we are getting ready to as we reopen the church in the following months. But you can go to our website at faithsouthbay.org for details, or look out for our May issue of our Good News, our newsletter, as it is coming out this week. So here are some updates that we would love for you to join us just coming up in this next week. So please join us after worship today for our Zoom coffee and fellowship hour. And so you can go to our website to find the link, or you can get it right here at our Zoom meeting ID and just call in. At 1 o'clock, though, we have a different Zoom link for one of our special classes. It is our Like Apples and Oranges, three workshops on Asian Americans, race, and power. And this will be our second of three. And the date, the third date has actually changed to May 2nd because of Mother's Day. So we have a session today at 1 o'clock and next Sunday at 1 o'clock as well. You can go to tinyurl.com/likeapplesoranges. As well as that Asian American class, we wanted to invite you to a literature class that is happening on Thursday evenings. And so it is from, it started this Thursday, but it goes until May 22nd. You can always join us if you want to register at tinyurl.com/AES lit class. You will be directed to a different link for that class as well. So we hope that you will join us, and we thank you for being a part of these workshops and classes, as we know that we are living in a time where there has been a lot of anti-Asian sentiment and racism in our common communities and worlds. And so we are talking about how we as a faith community move forward through all of this and in solidarity with others. We also want to remind folks that there are Bible studies and small groups that are happening all throughout the week. And so if you would like to connect to one of them, you can let us know at the church office that you're interested, or you can check out the ones that are offered, and you can find them on our website. We also want to remind folks to bring your communion elements to worship next week, Sunday, as we celebrate the Great Thanksgiving, as we come together on Communion Sunday. If you would like your own consecrated element, if you don't have any at home, we have our little grape juice and wafer packets at church that are blessed. So you can come and call in the office, and Sandy will put some aside for you. We have two other announcements that are upcoming, so please stay on the lookout for news about a Children's Day drive-through, and that will be next week, Saturday, as well as a Mother's Day drive-through, which will be happening May 8th. So please stay with the news and keep in contact and RSVP for these so we have a head count. And the last thing before I bring back Pastor Key is to remind you that we will be putting out a COVID survey. It's a very short survey. You can go to tinyurl.com/faithumcsurvey, but there will also be a hard copy survey in your Good News as well as an emailed one. But we are trying to gauge where our congregation is at as we reopen. And we want to bring you back to the safest community possible. And so we are very excited about the possibilities of reentry and reopening, and want you to be a part of that. And so we thank you for being a part of our Faith in Action. And at this time, I'd like to invite Pastor Key to send us off with a blessing.
At this time, let us go ahead and receive the benediction. Now may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Folks, we'll see you next week. Have a great week. Have a safe week. Have a faithful week.
Grandma used to pray out loud by your bed every night. To me it sounded like mumbling, like she was out of her mind. She said, boy, this kind of praying, it's what saved my life. You ought to try it sometime. And now I know she was right. She was talking to Jesus. She was talking to Jesus. And she'd been talking to Jesus for all of her life. Mama used to drag me to church Sunday mornings and Wednesday night. Khaki pants and a polo shirt. Boy, I put up a fight. She said, son, one day you'll thank me for having God in your life. And yeah, I know she was right. Yeah, my mama was right. Cause now I'm talking to Jesus. She got me talking to Jesus. She got me talking to Jesus. Yeah, my mama was right. Cause now I'm talking to Jesus. Yeah, I love talking to Jesus. And I'll be talking to Jesus for the rest of my life. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Don't you know? What a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, what a friend we have. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Whoa. I've got three of my own now, trying to raise them upright. My oldest is 15. I remember what that was like. Trying to deal with the drama, trying to figure out the questions in life. And I've been looking for a way to show him how to make it all right. Then he walks in my room while I was saying my prayers the other night. Said, I'll come back later. I can tell you got a lot on your mind. I said, it's not an interruption. You couldn't have picked a better time. Cause I was just talking to Jesus. Come over and give it a try. We started talking to Jesus. Bad time to start. It don't have to sound pretty. Just tell them what's on your heart. Cause it's not a religion. Cause it's more like a friendship. So just talk to your father like you are his kid. Just
start talking to Jesus. Just start talking to Jesus. You can talk to Jesus. Oh, whenever you like. Just start talking to Jesus. Just start talking to Jesus. Just keep talking to Jesus. The rest of your